When you think of Matt McMuscles, what visuals flash through your mind? Godzilla? Final Fight? Cereal? J-Cups? Yeah, that last one's bad example, but would you believe a puzzle game actually makes up a percentage of my mind palace? No, even I wouldn't think that, but it's true. There is a puzzle series I love so much that, hell, I decided to make my own video about it. And I've fooled you all into watching it, hopefully. So without further ado, I proudly present the Puzzle League Retrospective.
Nintendo!
To do this series justice, we need to rewind back to the magical time period of 1995, which mathematically is smack dab in the middle of the immortal 90s, where Nintendo had a good amount of its own puzzle games spread across the NES, the Game Boy, and of course the mighty SNES. Wario's Woods, Tetris, Dr. Mario, Yoshi's Cookie, Picross, it was pretty clear that there was ain't no shortage of puzzlers if you were a Nintendo fan. But, in my humble opinion, one game towered above them all. Panel de Pon was developed by Intelligent Systems, the creators of Fire Emblem, Advance Wars, Paper Mario, and lots of other future Nintendo classics, and released for the Super Famicom in late 95. The core of Panel de Pon can be distilled to a field where a stack of different colored blocks move upward, and it's up to the player to get rid of the blocks within certain winning conditions, like clearing everything above a predetermined line or filling up another player's screen in competitive play. This is done via a cursor, which can flip two block positions horizontally, and you want to match up three or more of the same color. This then deletes the blocks and everything just falls down to make up for the newly opened space. But shut up, there's more! You can still move your cursor around during these moments, and if you have enough big dick energy, you can position more blocks to build up a chain of combos to delete more and more in a glorious cacophony of colorful block mayhem. It's awesome, it's addictive, and it's my favorite style of puzzle game, bar none. That's the gameplay, but Panel de Pon also made a name for itself for actually featuring a story. It centers around the evil king Thanatos, who's featured in another Intelligent Systems game, Battle Clash, who then messes up a magical world of fairies which causes infighting, and it's up to our MC, Lip, to set things right. She needs to defeat the other fairies one after another until she can puzzle battle Thanatos to death. Yes, that's the plot. Now, this is all well and good, but if you can smell the footage you're seeing right now and really use your ears to visually examine the graphics, you might feel a wave of nostalgia if you played a lot of Nintendo games on the Super Nintendo or even the N64. Panel de Pon is simply the Japanese version of the better known and almost the exact same Tetris Attack, which hit North American shores in 96. Nintendo still had a good relationship with the Tetris company at the time and felt the game needed something a bit more recognizable to sell overseas. Yoshi's Cookie wasn't exactly a runaway hit, so rather than use the Green Dino's name again on another puzzle game, they settled for using the Tetris moniker, despite it having nothing to do with Tetris. The Attack part of the name came from the much faster and more aggressive style the game adopted, not to mention the fact that in competitive play, you are actively attacking the other player by making big combo, which results in dropping junk onto your rival. For all intents and purposes, however, this is the same game. It just swaps out Lip and the other fairies with characters who appeared in Super Mario World 2, Yoshi's Island, like Poochie, Raphael the Raven, and even Bowser, who is more than happy to step into Thanatos' evil shoes. The story is even a carbon copy, with the Koopa King wrecking havoc across the land and causing other creatures and characters to be evil, while it's up to Yoshi to puzzle their heads back on straight. The sound effects of your cursor moving around, the combo is building up, even the music is all shared between both versions. So, to reiterate, Japan equals fairies. USA, Yoshi. I hope that simplifies things. No matter which version you play, the game is so damn colorful and oozing with 16-bit charm out of every orifice. From the cute shouts of victory when a round is won, or the calming music which then explodes into an explosion of stress and tension, to the breezy animations and the chibi representations of the selected characters, you are in for a good time. The Game Boy version of Tetris Attack is exactly that. A Game Boy version of Tetris Attack. It's uglier, sounds worse, but the gameplay is there, and it's portable, so there's that. Oddly enough, while there was no GB version of Panel Dupont in Japan, Tetris Attack was eventually relocalized for Japan a few months later. Weird. But wait, what's weirder than that, you say? Well, earlier I mentioned the Nintendo 64, so a version of Panel Dupont that might be the most popular of all is Pokemon Puzzle League, which released in 2000 and heavily revolved around the anime as it was hot at the time, and kind of ignored a lot of the presentation and style of the other Pokemon games of the era. Yoshi was out, and Ash, Ketchum, and Pikachu were in, and the core gameplay remained the same, but the music, sound effects, and the story were all about damn pocket monsters. Why this version is so notable is that it stretches the N64 cartridges to an absolute limit, as it features full motion video clips of the anime itself, and uses that to pepper its story mode, which plays out a lot like Tetris Attack.
Ash, being selected for this event is such an honor. Well, there's no time to explain everything. You must hurry.
Well, let's go!
Wait! Don't forget to come and see me in my office in Puzzle League Village!
Yeah!
Did you hear me, Ash?
Ash is tasked by Dr. Oak to wreck shit throughout the Kanto region, not via Pokemon battling, but with puzzle battling. It's unclear if the Pokemon actually do anything, as it seems it's just kind of the humans pushing around small blocks with their fingertips. Anyway, you fight various gym leaders, then move on to Team Rocket, and then finally take on Giovanni himself in a knockdown drag-out brawl between a fully grown man who runs a crime syndicate and a child. But hey, it's all within the context of a puzzle game, so it's fine, I guess. The game is just as good, if not better, than Tetris Attack, and in 2000, I loved Pokemon and was watching the anime whenever I could, so fuck yeah, Pokemon Puzzle League. Despite it though being the same core gameplay, it does have a few new features, including a mode that has a somewhat 3D field where you had to rotate a cylindrical tube to stay on top of all your blocks. The game was a lot faster to boot, and the AI opponents were all more challenging, thanks to Nintendo 64 having a bit more horsepower to afford to these areas over their 16-bit versions. The Pokemon train, however, was full steam ahead, and since it was a series popular to have on the go, it made sense for Nintendo to also create a Game Boy Color version called Pokemon Challenge in North America, in Europe, and Pokemon Dupanelpon in Japan. Much like the Tetris Attack Game Boy port, this is a no-frills affair that simply packs in the great gameplay for when you're on the go. But being on the GBC at least now has the colors popping and the game moving at a faster clip. You can buy this version on the 3DS Virtual Console if you have a hankering for some turn-of-the-century Pokemon puzzle fun. Panel Dupont, oddly enough, would step back into the limelight from under the shadow of Pokemon in 2003 when it was re-released on the GameCube in Japan alongside Dr. Mario and Yoshi's Cookie in Nintendo Puzzle Collection, which sadly was never released outside the country. Why this version gets a special mention is that even though it's simply just called Panel Dupont and is featured in what is most obviously a collection, It's actually a full-on sequel. The story now takes place several years later and revolves around a younger cast of descendants of the fairies from the Super Famicom original. Jesus, this has to be the most hidden sequel of all time. It features upgraded graphics and speed as well, and it's basically a Japanese version of Pokemon Puzzle League, which actually was only released in North America and Europe. So, again, paneled upon is paneled upon in Japan, but in every other country in the world, it's anything but paneled upon. After that brief stint with the GameCube, it was back to handhelds. But even though the incredibly popular DS came out in 2004, almost a full year later, the GBA saw the two-pack, Dr. Mario and Puzzle League. This marked the first time Nintendo of America called it something different without relying on the marquee value of Pokemon or Yoshi. They just dropped the Pokemon and kept the Puzzle League. Yeah, that's good enough. Of course, the Japanese release was called Dr. Mario and Paddled Upon, so we're still forever steering that ship away from the scary shores of fairies and magic. In its place is nothing. Just generic colored backgrounds and sound effects making it, presentation-wise at least, a very dishwater puzzler, which is a shame since the gameplay is still as frantic as ever. If you still use your GBA or original DS, seek it out if you want a decent bang for your buck. Dr. Mario is also kind of based on the N64 version, which is a nice bonus. Unfortunately, and, you know, too fast for my liking, we are reaching the end of all the big combos, chains, and colored blocks, as only one major release is left in the paneled upon Puzzle League extended universe. In 2007, it was announced Planet Puzzle League was being released for the DS proper, and I remember losing my mind at this bold, bold move. Initially though, I didn't even realize Nintendo had changed the name of the series, as that GBA 2-pack had passed me by, so it did take me a fiery second to just go, oh, yes, this is my beloved Tetris Attack / Pokemon Puzzle Kumite! I was big into the DS Lite at this time, and I would jump in the way of an assassin's bullet to save its fucking life. So the stakes were pretty high with this release. It's basically a deluxe ultimate version of the game that used all the DS's bells and whistles that it possibly could. You can play the game vertically to increase the play field. You can use the stylus to move the cursor, which greatly increases your reaction time, and you can even duke it out in multiplayer, either through DS wireless local play, or even go at it online with people around the world. If you are looking to get into this series, this is a great place to start and end if you value the gameplay above all else. However, I have to mention something that came up a bit earlier, the presentation. Without any characters or story, the game does come off as distinctly bland, and mostly features a lot of shapes, colors, and geometric backgrounds. They tried to do their best to inject some sort of personality within this aesthetic, but you can only do so much. The music is at least a little lively with some decent selection of tracks, but still pales in comparison to the charming 16-bit tunes of Tetris Attack and the memorable music of Pokemon circa 2000. This is my only gripe with the game, and while it's not a deal-breaker by any stretch, it just sort of bums me out that Nintendo couldn't really decide how they wanted to market this series. But we'll get to that in a bit. Regardless, I poured dozens and dozens of hours into this release, as it was a perfect portable title you could quickly fire up on a bus or a subway ride, and because of the addictive gameplay, you'd be at your destination before you know it. Oh, right, the game was called Paneled Upon DS in Japan, try not to sound too shocked, but Nintendo did strip out the world and fairies this time around, so at least graphically, the games were finally in parity with each other. Personally, I prefer the magical underpinnings and characters from the originals, but I guess this now fits with the Brain Age, Wii Fit presentation style Nintendo was going for at the time. going back to where I said Nintendo really didn't know what they were doing marketing-wise, someone from the Tetris company actually said in an interview years later, "I regret letting Nintendo use the Tetris name for that particular game. Hey, panel upon, it's a good game. The Tetris name just didn't fit it at all," which I kind of agree with, but at the time, when that game came out, I didn't fucking care. Using the Tetris name there did kind of put an identity crisis on this series, as they really couldn't decide if they wanted to be paneled upon, Pokemon, Tetris Attack, Yoshi. There's so many mixed up aesthetics for this series. I'm glad they finally settled on something, even if it wasn't as memorable as all those things previously mentioned. Now, going back to the late aughts, this truly was a time where the Big N was experimenting with a lot of different things. And building off of Planet Puzzle League, there was one more minor release, which was the DSiWare version of the game. Remember DSiWare? No, you don't. Anyway, this was Nintendo's first baby steps into downloadable content on a handheld, and most games were basic stripped-down versions of prior releases. This was no different, as all three SKUs across each territory had a different moniker: Puzzle League Express in North America, Choto Panel Dupon for Japan, and the best name of them all, A Little Bit of Puzzle League in Europe. These all came out in 2009 and featured four different modes, and there's honestly not much more to say than that. But it's a neat curio in the history of the series. Since that time, however, Nintendo hasn't done much with the League of Extraordinary Puzzling, aside from a minigame in Animal Crossing New Leaf on the 3DS, but a proper new entry in the series doesn't really seem to be in the cards anytime soon. While we can surmise that none of the games were blockbuster successes, Nintendo still carried on with multiple versions of releases for well over a decade, so it seemingly had a good run, and why wouldn't it? The satisfying sound of completing a massive combo, the flickering of your eyes to your opponent's screen to see if they're in deep as shit as you, the sweat pouring down your face as you try to clear those last few blocks. Puzzle League, or Pound Upon, or whatever you want to call it, is the perfect example, to me, of puzzle games at their absolute best. Now, while I'd love a new release, I'm more than happy with what's currently out there, as at least one version is available to download at any given time, and physical copies shouldn't set you back too much either. Also, as an aside, if you want to see me destroy Wooly in head-to-head mode, make sure to click the link at the end of this video to see absolute prime shit bopping. Thanks for bearing with me on this incredibly specific video about a series that's near and dear to me. I super appreciate it. Now, back to our regularly scheduled programming of Punisher and Godzilla shit. If there's any other games, though, that you'd like to see me do a retrospective of, let me know in the comments or hit me up at mattmuscles@gmail.com. Thanks for watching.